Our afternoon devotional on Fridays. Really nice to be with you today. Thank you for inviting me into your home, your car, or wherever you're at, however you're listening to this. How many times have you been asked, who's your favorite Bible character? I've been asked that question a lot of times. I've been in situations like at camps and places, who's your favorite Bible character? I think that's a great, great question. Well, today we're going to talk about my favorite Bible character other than Jesus, my favorite Bible character. And you may have a lot different characters, but I'm going to share with you my character, who I think probably epitomizes more than anything else what it really means to be a believer in Jesus Christ. Okay? Let's pray together. Thank you, Jesus, for this time. Thank you for the opportunity to open your word and open our hearts to a character in our word that we can embrace. And I thank you for we pray and ask this in Jesus' name. You've probably heard me, but then again, maybe not, share with you that my favorite Bible character is Barnabas. My favorite Bible character after Jesus is Barnabas. If there is one person who exhibits to me how I would like to live out my life as a Christian believer, it's Barnabas. And so, even though Barnabas and I are probably not alike in any way, his character in Christ is one that intrigues me, that I find delightful to think about and talk about. It doesn't mean that it wasn't without difficulties and dilemmas, because it was, and probably had its heartache and its share of sorrows. But it is also an account of a man transformed and changed by the person and work of Jesus Christ. And that speaks volume to me. And the way he did that and the way he walked in that speaks volumes to me. So today, we're going to ramble around the Mideast, and I'm going to talk about my favorite Bible character. First of all, the interesting thing about my favorite Bible character is that he had his name changed. His name was Joseph, J-O-S-E-S, in the New King James Version. Also, alliterated could be Joseph. So he was somebody who had a very different name than what he was given. We know him as Barnabas. You know, none of us really talk about him as Joseph. Let me share with you the introduction of Joseph into the Bible and the introduction of this character who I have called my favorite character after Jesus. This is found in the book of Acts, and we're going to go to chapter 4, the book of Acts. And in that book of Acts, we come to near the end of chapter 4, and it says this, "And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles," which is translated "son of encouragement," or "son of consolation," or "son of prophecy." Here it tells us he's known as the son, oh man, of encouragement. I don't know about you, but encouragement. Times that I have received encouragement, times that I have been allowed the privilege to encourage, those are some of the best times in my Christian walk. And sometimes that encouragement comes after a really, really tough time, a really, really difficult time. And sometimes someone will come into my heart and I call them and I say, "How did you know? How did you know?" Well, I don't know that I did know, but I was allowed for a moment to kind of peek into the person of Barnabas or Joseph here. So let's look a little bit further about him. He says that he was a Levite. So he was somebody who came out of the Levitical priesthood family. He was somebody who would we expect who would be a really staunch believer in the Hebrew faith. You know, we would expect him to be steeped in the law of Moses. We expect him to be somebody who knows the law, somebody who knows the Mishnah, somebody who knows Torah. We would expect him to be somebody who had those things in his life that made him identified with the Levitical or the priesthood caste in the family of God as we see it in the Old Testament. It also says that he was from Cyprus. Now, probably one of the more overglossed things is that he's from Cyprus. He wasn't from Jerusalem. He wasn't from what we would technically call the Mideast. He comes from Cyprus. Now, Cyprus is that little island. Back when I was a very, very young child, probably just learning to walk, there was a major incident about Cyprus. And Cyprus over the years has been torn between rule and rulers, who's in charge of it. It's just always been one of those places. Since it's a large island in the Mediterranean, it had a lot of commercial needs. And so it was wanted. People needed to and wanted to control Cyprus. So it's where he came from. Then it goes on to say this. Having land, sold it, and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. Many of you realize that in the early church, they practiced a communal living. It's an interesting study. It didn't work, but it was an interesting study. There is that sense in which that group of believers in Jerusalem held everything in common. In other words, as the church was birthed and born, they had a mutual aid society. You know, people would bring their paychecks, or they would bring their produce. In this case, he sold land and brought it to the disciples and said, this is for the church. This is for the church to function. You know that the rise of the election of deacons in the early church came out of the fact that they fed widows. And so there was this social element to the church where they took care of people, where they had things in common, where they took the opportunity to live out a communal Christian life. For the most part, it didn't work. It didn't extend past. And very few true Christian communal organizations or organizations will have to work because I can't think of something else other than that. Like the Bruderhof. Many of you may be familiar with the Bruderhof. It's just not one of the things that stuck was this communal idea. But what we find is he comes in, sells his property, lays it at their feet. This also came about as a pretty interesting event in that that's probably one of the reasons why they changed his name from Joseph, or Joseph, to Barnabas, son of consolation. We have every reason to believe, though I can't prove it, that the gift was significant. And that the gift was born out of his love for the church and his love for Jesus Christ. It is probable that he was there on the day of Pentecost. And he was one of the 3,000 who responded. Because remember, as a Levite and as somebody from Cyprus, he would have come to Jerusalem for Passover. He'd have come to Jerusalem for Pentecost. He'd have come to Jerusalem, for a Feast of Tabernacles. He'd have come. And so it is surmised that he was in that group. And in that early fledgling church, he takes a position of leadership. And because of that, they change his name. Well, you remember Ananias and Sapphira. I'm not here to talk about them. They're not my favorite people in Scripture. But his action was counterfeited by them. And of course, you know that account. But one of the reasons why it was counterfeited was because I think they saw the esteem. And maybe Ananias didn't like his name and wanted his name changed. But he and Sapphira had the opportunity. It was clear that this is what they were taught. The property was yours. If you sold it, you could give all of it. If you sold it, you could keep part of it. There was nothing that says you had to give it all. But they portrayed themselves as giving it all. And so they lied to God and they lied to the Holy Spirit. Barnabas, on the other hand, probably goes back to Cyprus somewhere. Or maybe he stays with the early church. What we find is him cropping up again in Acts chapter 9. Now let me tell you what's happened from Acts chapter 4 to Acts chapter 9. The Apostle Paul's converted on the Damascus Road. And the Apostle Paul begins to preach in Damascus. And the Apostle Paul then has to be snuck out of Damascus by being let down by a basket because he had caused such a furor in preaching Jesus. Then Paul comes to Jerusalem, but Jerusalem won't accept him. The church didn't trust him as a disciple. And so he goes away. He goes back into Tarsus. And that's where he received his visions. That's where he began to minister. Then we find he comes back to the apostles. And now it is Barnabas who is pleading his case. I want to read that to you. It's in Acts chapter 9, verse 7. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. And he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road and how he had spoken to him and how he had preached boldly at Damascus the name of Jesus. So he was with them at Jerusalem, coming in and going out. And he spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus and disputed against the Hellenists, but they attempted to kill him. That's Paul. Okay? But Barnabas introduced him. They weren't going to accept him. They weren't going to receive him. And Paul made Damascus too hot to hold him and Jerusalem too hot to hold him. But somewhere in between there, here comes Barnabas. Introduces him. We see Barnabas again when we come into chapter 11. And in chapter 11, he takes the opportunity to be part of taking an offering for Jerusalem because there's going to be a famine and food is going to get short and the church that is at Jerusalem is going to need help. And so an offering is taken. In the book of Acts, we find that when the apostles hear that there's this incredible church that's being planted and people coming to Christ at Antioch, who do they send? Well, they send Barnabas. Who does Barnabas get? He brings Paul. And that church begins to develop and blossom. And pretty soon what we find is that church then comes to the apostles. And comes to the apostles and says, look, do we really have to become Jewish to become believers? So Barnabas is in all of these things, always being that son of consolation, that son of encouragement, always being that person. We later on find that Barnabas and Paul are separated out of the church of Antioch to go on to the missions. First missions, missionary journey. Where do they go first? You got it. Where they know the most people. Where's that? Cyprus. We find that they go to Cyprus. And Cyprus becomes a jumping off spot to all of the Middle East. We find this incredible, incredible missionary journey. Then we find the contention that comes up with John Mark. Barnabas is set on taking him. He feels that John Mark has learned his lesson. He deserved a second chance. Paul didn't want that. So Paul and Silas go somewhere else, ultimately leading them into Europe. And we find that Mark and Barnabas go back to Cyprus. And from there, they begin, again, another set of ministry journeys. And so the missionary force of the early church is doubled. And it was doubled because of one man's obstinacy and another man's encouragement. You know later on as well, if you skip a few years here, that Barnabas at some point passes away because we no longer find him in the record. But we know that John Mark has hooked up with Peter. And that John Mark is John Mark becomes the author of Mark, which has been traditionally considered as Peter's version of Jesus, of the gospel. Well, we find that Paul then writes later on about John Mark being a fellow laborer, and that John Mark was beneficial to him, that John Mark could help him. And so we find that rift is now corrected. You know, he is profitable to Paul, and Paul wants him to come and minister with him. Oh man, where do you think that heart came from? I think that heart came from the residual legacy of a man named Barnabas. Favorite character. That's kind of a short thumbnail biblical excursion into his life. But why do I connect with him so much? Because actually Barnabas and I are not probably very much alike. You know, now we both were new converts at one time, but he was rich. I wasn't, haven't been. But he gave. I understand that giving. He gave because of his love for the Lord Jesus. I get that. And because he believed, and because he was esteemed, he changed his name and gave him a character name. You know, the Apostle Peter. Peter wasn't his name. His name was Cephas. Jesus changed it. Whoa! Neat. And other people have had their names changed. You know, because there becomes a significance about them. And that significance is this issue of encouragement and consolation. I don't want us to keep reading into our day and age, our right now, our COVID pandemic, our culturally challenged day, our socially, seemingly angst in our world today, in our country today. What would happen if there would be a powerful group of encouragers? I see all sorts of things about protesters. Why don't I see some things about encouragers? Now, I'm not talking about people who encourage protesters. Encouragers, people who really want. One of my great things that I have to keep in my spirit settled down is the politicizing of COVID-19. And unfortunately, it's both sides of our governmental system. Okay? Of course, I think one side's worse than the other, and I'd be less than candid with you. I didn't say that, and I'll probably regret that I did say it. But I did, and I still mean it. But how about some encouragers? How about somebody coming up and standing up and saying, hey, well, you realize we really are in this together. I see that in many COVID-19 things. We're all in this together. We need each other. How many people have you called? And I hate to put that on you. How many people have you called to encourage just to see how they're doing? Hey, you know, when I was in my first church, there was a guy. His name was Charlie Moore. I went to college with his son, Paul Moore. And I knew their younger son, Ed Moore. And Charlie Moore was on the radio station, WDBA. And I remember every once in a while, he would say, hey, I want you to send a card to and put in a dime, a quarter, a nickel. And so people got sending cards who listened to, I remember listening to him. I remember him encouraging people on the air. You know, it was just one of those things that I always, always admired about Charlie Moore. And times in my life where I was encouraged by he and his wife Irma. Times in which you and I have been encouraged by somebody like them who's come up and said, you know, how are you? Can I? Should I? Do you need? I just wanted to call you. Even Stevie Wonder, I just called. What? To say I love you. Just called to say I'm thinking of you. Encouragers. One of the reasons why Barnabas is one of my favorite Bible characters, you always see him coming to encourage. Whether it's encouraging the early church in its communal lifestyle, whether it's coming into defense to Saul, who became Paul, or whether it's pleading the case of John Mark, or whether it's gathering an offering for the church at Jerusalem, or whether it's standing and preaching to the church in Antioch and then on his missionary journeys, or he's my favorite because of that. And though I don't always kind of embody everything there is to him, I can certainly respect and at times, through Holy Spirit work in my life, be a Barnabas. I like that idea. I really like this character. Might each of us realize we can be raised up as encouragers. And do that in Jesus' name. Thanks for letting me come share with you my favorite Bible character. From time to time, if you want to tell me who yours is, go ahead and let me know why. Thank you. Bye now.